We're studying the book of Proverbs. And have you ever gotten sick and the last thing you ate before you got sick, you never wanted to eat that again? Well, this was the message that I was planning when I got sick. And so, like, I was thinking about preaching it. Fortunately, Dave Neckers came and filled in wonderfully. This last week, Caleb said, well, why don't we just switch? Since I've got something prepared for next week, why don't I do that? So I've been working on this message for 3 weeks. Actually, it's been working on me. And there have been many times when I said, I want to scrap it. I don't want to preach this message. I don't want to do it. I hate it because of I've gotten sick in the middle of it. But it's God's word, and I believe it's God's word that needs to go forth. Something wanted to keep it from being shared. I want to make sure that it gets shared so we can be done with it. Proverbs, we've been teaching on Proverbs, and I had this one thought a few weeks ago. I thought, where is the grace in Proverbs? Like, there's grace in all of the scriptures, and the message of the gospel is all about grace, but where is grace in Proverbs? And then I realized, as the Lord just began to open my eyes to decisions, wise decisions that my parents had made on my behalf, in a lifestyle that they had helped raise up within me. And one particular day, the Lord just said, if I could open your eyes to all the things that I have saved you from that you didn't have to experience. Like, there's preventative grace, where you don't have to go through it and experience it. You don't have to go through the sin and be forgiven of it. That God just says, I want to spare you of that. I want to spare you of the pain of that. And so the wisdom and discipline of the Proverbs can save us from so much pain, and if we just begin to listen to it. In Proverbs chapter 6, there's this one section that I've wrestled with, not just for 3 weeks, but probably for 30 years. And it says this: there are 6 things the Lord hates. Is it just me, or we've all been raised with the fact that God is a God of love, not a God of hate? And so it seems kind of odd that there would be things that God hates. We kind of believe that God, the God of love, wouldn't hate anything. Yet I want to assert this morning that the opposite of love is not hate. The opposite of love is apathy. It's just not caring. And sometimes the passion of love is expressed in, there are things that you love, and when you love something about somebody, there are some things that, like, you would hate to experience in that. Nobody that loves someone also doesn't hate cheating on them. You know, there's something, you want them to be faithful to you. Do you understand what this means? That there are some things that God hates because he loves us so much. And so this passage begins with, there are 6 things the Lord hates, 7 that are detestable to him. Which is it, 6 things or 7 things? Whenever this is mentioned in the Proverbs, and this is mentioned several times where he says, like, there are 3 things or 4 things, what he's saying is, this is going to be a specific list, but not an exhaustive list. In other words, he's going to tell some things that are on the list, but this is not the only things that are on the list. They just describe a certain way of living. In fact, I would say that there is one thing that makes up all 6 or 7 of these, and we're going to describe that in a little bit. So he says there are 6 things the Lord hates. I think it would be beautiful if we could love the things that God loves and we could hate the things that God hates. We get a picture of what he is like. And so let's begin to look at this. He says, haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush into evil, a false witness who pours out lies, and a person who stirs up conflict in the community. So when I said the thing, there are six things the Lord hates, did yours make the list? You're like, wow, I think I would have put this and this and this on the list. What is it about this list of things that the Lord hates? I just want to kind of walk through them because I believe that there's one thing that underlies each one of them. First one he describes is haughty eyes. Eyes are things that you see with. It's the perspective that you have. It is your worldview. And so what would it be like to have a worldview that was haughty? You know, the word haughty means proud. Or when you have haughty eyes, you look down on others. So it's a perspective that when you see others, you begin to look down upon them. When you see others, you begin to think, I am better than this other person. And God detests that kind of an attitude. God detests that kind of perspective. You could describe it as life is all about me. And everybody else is here because the world just revolves right around me. You know, at this very moment, it says that there's kind of two perspectives going on. There's our life that we live on earth, but it says in heaven that the seven elders are surrounding the throne of God. They're casting their crowns at his feet. And night and day, there are praises rising to our God. You ever have one of those, Bath and Body Works candles? You know, you light it and you keep it lit all day long and your house begins to smell like whatever the fragrance was that you chose for your house to smell like. It says in heaven, when the elders are surrounding the throne, it's a fragrance that's burning before God, that is a wonderful aroma before him, because God is at the center of it all. We are not the center of our universe. God is at the center of our universe, and we were made to worship him. You hear the song that we talked about, that night and day let incense arise. That's our praise. And then Micaiah shared the tag, I want to burn for you, I want to burn for you. This is a good plug for the burn that literally is this happening in our community right here this week. On Friday morning from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., we're going to have just worship happening all day long within our building. It'll be happening in the garage. There are worship leaders coming in from all different churches in town. They take two-hour shifts, and they just lead so that there would be 12 hours of praise going up before God. You could come for 15 minutes. You could come for a half hour or an hour of just saying, day and night, my praise is going to rise to you. What happens if this doesn't happen? We begin to think that life revolves around us. And people are put here on earth for our benefit. And that's kind of what the haughty eyes are. The second thing on the list is a lying tongue. In fact, this is the only thing on the list that's mentioned twice. Later, a little bit later on, it talks about a false witness who stirs up lies. What causes you and me to lie? When's the last time you lied? I believe that there are two kinds of lies that we have in our lives. One is the intentional lie that we speak, and then one is an unintentional lie that we speak in our lives. Have you ever lied on purpose? Like somebody came up to you, they caught you in a situation, and you just to cover up for it, you lied. What was that all about? What caused you to lie in a particular situation? Wasn't it, I'm going to use the truth, or use a lie actually, I'm going to use a lie to make myself look better. To make myself look better, to make myself more understood, to let people, to cover up the bad or to highlight the good. And really this lying tongue is again the same thought. It's all about me. And how can I bend the truth in order that I would look good? This one is used twice in here because I also believe that there's not just the intentional lie. Sometimes we can live an unintentional lie. It kind of goes like this. Did you know there's a phrase now that it's not just truth, but it's my truth? What would be the difference between your truth and the truth? There shouldn't be any. The truth should be the truth. You know what we call my truth? It's really what we should say is my perspective. It's the way I look at things, and this is the way I've kind of looked at things and see things. It's my perspective. But you know what? When truth becomes my truth, it's really not truth any longer. And we really need to come to the point where we say, it's not about my truth, it is about the truth. And there could be things that I just don't know about this world. There could be things that I have yet to see that could correct my view of the world. Where does lying come from? It's really similar things. It's to make myself look good, or it's just to highlight what I see in this world. Let's move on in the list. Not just haughty eyes, a lying tongue. There's hands that shed innocent blood. I put this in, it's how we look at power in our life. Because whether we know it or not, or whether we see it or not, aren't there kind of two groups of people in this world? There are people that have power to do something for us, and there are other people in this world that really don't have the power to do much for us. When he talks about the innocent, you could say it's the weak, it's the powerless, it is the orphan, it is the widow. It is people that don't have the influence, don't have the power. And if we begin to treat people who are powerless different than we treat people who are powerful, what does that say about us? It makes a huge statement, doesn't it, that life is about us and what people can do for us. It says, you know what God hates? Is when you and I treat people differently based on what they can do for us. When you and I were just the opposite, we were called to make life better for the powerless, the innocent, the weak, the oppressed. And when we don't do that, when we choose not to do that, when we choose not to use our power to help somebody else who's weak, that's basically saying that life has become about us and what others can do for us. Let's move on. And then the next one, a heart that devises wicked schemes. You know, every one of us has this incredible creative power within us. This creative power, we can plan things, we can strategize, we can make the world look differently based on the thoughts and the dreams and the innovations and the things that we come up with. Every one of us has the power to do this, and God calls us to do it. There's an infinitely kind of creative power within us. Do you know what happens when we begin to use that incredible innovation, that incredible design and creativity, in order to come up with things that just benefit us? He calls it a wicked scheme. A few years back, I was at a party, and one of the things that we said at the party, somebody came up with this great question. The question was, if you were going to rob a bank, how would you do it? And so the group just began to think about, like, well, you know, and there were kind of different ideas. You know, I would do it this way or that way. Oh, no, you would get caught if you did it this way. And we began to think about, together as a group, how would you rob a bank if you could get away with it? How would you do this? We did this for a while, and one of my friends said, you know what? This is making my mind go crazy right now. Like, just putting my mental energy towards how I would rob a bank, it's really kind of making my mind go dark. You know, that's similar for every one of us. We've got this energy. We've got this creativity that we can put it towards how can I get out of life something for myself? Or we could say, how can I give? Remember at the first of this year, I asked you to create something this year. I want you to begin to think about it. Plan for it. Strategize. Devise something that should be and could be in this world, because God made you to create. If you don't, then it can become about us. Do you follow what there's one thing that's making all of these things? Let's move on. It says, feet that are quick to rush into evil. Feet that are quick to rush into evil. You know, you and I, when we are excited about something, when we are passionate about something, nobody has to talk us into doing it. We are like, we're ready to go. We get there early. And that's kind of what he's talking about. It's the passion of your life. What gets you going? What is the thing that nobody has to talk you into it? You just, like, you're ready to go for this. I'm looking forward to watching the Purdue basketball game at noon. I saw on Twitter yesterday that the doors open for Mackey Arena 2 hours and 10 minutes early. That's somebody that doesn't want to just get there on time. They want to get there early. I was thinking, years ago, I was given a gift to go to Brooklyn Tabernacle for their prayer meeting. And we flew there. It's a Wednesday night prayer meeting that begins at 7 p.m. We got there before 5 o'clock because the doors opened at 5. And when we got there, there was already a line outside the building. And when they opened the doors 2 hours early, people ran in to prayer meetings. That's feet that's not quick to rush into evil. That's feet that are quick, passionate to run into God. Does God have your passion? Or is your passion about something that could make my life better? We've already talked about the false witness. We move on to the last one on the list, a person who stirs up conflict in the community. This is the influence of our life. What do you use your influence in? Is your influence used to bring people together? Is your influence used to tear people apart? And this is really important thing. Do you see the whole list? The list is a perspective of our eyes. Do we look down on people? It's what do we? How do we look towards the innocent and the weak and the oppressed? What do we do with our tongue? Is it to make ourselves look better? Is it to base our foundation upon our truth? Or does truth become our new foundation? And the whole list is about, am I the center of my universe? Or is God? I don't know if you've ever been to the circus where the clown begins to ride a bicycle. It's not just any ordinary bicycle, but it's a bicycle where the hub or the center of the wheel is just off a little bit. And so as the clown begins to ride the bike, you go up and down and up and down, and that's the chaotic circus of a life that's centered around ourselves. When the truth is, you know what God hates? He hates when we become the center of our own universe, because we were created for Him to be the center. We are not created to sing the song, I exalt me. It's like we exalt thee, God. That it's about you, and it's about laying our crowns before your feet. And this shift is so subtle, but it's the shift of joy. It's the shift that like the reason why God hates it is not because He hates us, it's because He loves us and wants so much good for us. And so really what it is God hates when we are on the throne of our own life. And He loves it when He is, because it makes such a difference. As we conclude here today, this is not about a moment. It's about a lifestyle. About saying, God, I don't want to live my life for here. It's not about me, and it's not about now. And it's not about right this place. It's about you, and it's about eternity, and it's about your throne and worshiping Him. So God, I pray today that you would teach us to put you on the throne of our lives. And as we look this week, have there been moments when you've used your words to make yourself look better? Have you used your power and influence to build up the kingdom of God or to tear others down? Have you used your passion to run into evil? Have you used your creativity and your planning and your strategy in order to get stuff for yourself? Or do you realize this morning the truth that you were made for God and you were made to build His kingdom up and you are made to revolve around Him? Let's stand and exalt Him here this morning. Got some great news for you. Jesus Christ is alive. He's still on the throne of this universe. He's the reigning King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and He is going home with you. You don't have to lie about your sin. You can confess it and let him erase it. You have enough in anything that you need this week. He is powerful in your life. I pray that you would go and be the church. In Jesus' name.